In this module, I will give you a brief introduction to the SPA-DET approach to data collection and analysis to determine quantities and qualities of fecal sludge at scales relevant for planning and management solutions, so from community to citywide scales. Estimates of quantities and qualities can be made at six places in the service chain. 1, excreta, or urine and feces. 2, total fecal sludge produced, which is excreta, together with anything else going into the containment, such as flush water, cleansing material, and rubbish. 3, the total amount of fecal sludge that accumulates with time, which is quite different from the amount that is produced, as rates of accumulation depend on factors such as infiltration and microbial degradation. 4, fecal sludge that is emptied but not collected. 5, fecal sludge that is emptied and collected but not delivered to treatment. And 6, what we want, fecal sludge that is emptied, collected, and delivered to treatment. In this module, we will focus on rates of accumulation, as it is the most important in terms of knowing the total quantities and qualities of fecal sludge that will require sustainable long-term management in your city. But it is the most difficult as it is underground, you cannot see it, and there are typically no records available. This schematic illustrates wastewater treatment. Each house is producing slightly different wastewater, but they are all connected to the centralized sewer system, and so wastewater is relatively homogenized during transport and relatively easier to predict as it comes into treatment facilities. In contrast, this is fecal sludge. You see that each house is much more variable, and in addition, it is collected batch-wise and delivered to treatment. So what we need is ways to average out these complexities, so that we can make predictions of what we need to manage at the community scale. This is a similar concept to modeling population dynamics. If you want to know how a population of insects are moving through a field, you would not take one insect and look at it under the microscope. You would have to zoom out and look at the population as a whole. Similarly, we cannot look inside of one individual pit latrine at a microscopic level to make predictions at the community level. Another important point to consider is that fecal sludge characteristics do not follow a normal distribution. This data is influent values at the Lubiji Wastewater and Fecal Sludge Treatment Facility during 2014. The blue bars show wastewater and the purple fecal sludge. You can see that fecal sludge has much greater concentrations and also follows a different distribution than wastewater. The average COD and the standard deviation of the values for fecal sludge are basically the same. That means that if you were using a normal distribution to predict what will arrive at the Lubiji treatment plant, 16% of the time, the COD value would be negative, which does not make sense. This is important to keep in mind that you cannot make assumptions about expected average values. At a minimum, we recommend to use median and first and third quartile values and to report and share all of your raw data. If you do not feel comfortable with non-parametric distributions, I recommend to revisit your statistics textbooks or hire a consultant to help with this. In the future, as more people share their raw data, we will be able to better understand these relationships and be able to make more general assumptions. If you have or are creating a data set, please share it with us. So what is SPA-DET data? SPA stands for spatially analyzable, for example, this map of Kampala showing very poor, poor, middle, and high income levels. With the data displayed in this way, you can visualize where different socioeconomic groups live within the city. DET stands for demographic, environmental, and technical. Our hypothesis is that DET data can be used as predictors of quantities and qualities of fecal sludge. It is not about causation. For example, demographic data, such as income level, does not cause different qualities or quantities of fecal sludge. But if we consistently observe statistical patterns or relationships, we can use DET data as predictors. This is the method that we have developed. It is a chapter in the book, Methods of Fecal Sludge Analysis. The first step is to set your objectives, as this will influence what, how, and where you will take your samples. For example, are you concerned about accumulation rates within a pit latrine? Or with what is arriving at treatment plants? Or do you just want to know whether or not sludge is pumpable by a vacuum truck? In the book chapter, there is much more information about sampling. But, for example, two approaches to measuring rates of accumulation are in situ with the full laser device we are developing to measure volumes of fecal sludge, or working together with manual or mechanical service providers during emptying operations to measure quantities and qualities during discharge at treatment plants. The next step is to develop an SFD, because this basic level of information is required before you can make logical assumptions about the city you are working in. Then you need to collect all available and relevant types of SPA-DET data and start to consider what you will need to collect yourself during the study. Where do you get types of SPA-DET data? From existing sources, such as census, municipality, research institutions, or open street maps. You can collect it yourself with a household questionnaire and from emptying service providers. We are also starting research to see if we can make algorithms that can map out DET data for cities based on the different spatial patterns in satellite images like you see here. For example, pit latrines in an informal settlement. Then, you need to conduct the study. As scientists, we would like to tell you that you have to have enough samples to be statistically significant. However, in reality, we are aware that resources are often limited. That is why we developed an iterative approach, where as more resources become available and you can collect more data, you can improve the quality of your estimations. For example, you could start with one neighborhood and then in the next round include additional neighborhoods, or start with samples from one category of income level and then extend to additional socioeconomic groups. You could work together with a local university to include student research projects on your Q&Q study. So in closing, my conclusions for you to take into your city approach include: using statistical relationships can improve usefulness and reduce costs of collecting data. Data collected in this fashion can improve estimates of quantities and qualities and predictive models for improved management solutions. With more data, we could develop mechanistic relationships to help lead to universal understandings of fecal sludge management. And for more information, please visit our website and the book, Methods for Fecal Sludge Analysis. Thanks for joining. See you next time.